विनेंद्र तीर्थ स्वामी जी ಬಿಡಿಗೆ ಮಾಡಿ ದ ಚೇರ್ಮನ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಪಿ ಶ್ರೀಪತಿ ತಾಂತ್ರಿ ಜಿ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಭೈರಪ್ಪ ಜಿ ದ ಸೆಕ್ರೆಟರಿ ಶ್ರೀ ವಿಶ್ವನಾಥ್ ಪಾದೂರ್ ಜಿ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರುರಾಜ ಭಟ್ಸ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಇಲಸ್ಟ್ರಿಯಸ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಂಡೀಡ್ ಎ ಪ್ಲೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನಲ್ ಪ್ಲೆಷರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರಿವಿಲೇಜ್ ಫಾರ್ ಮೀ ಟು ಬಿ ಹಿಯರ್ ಟುಡೇ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಫೈನ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ಲೆಟ್ ಮೀ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಮೈ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ವಿತ್ ದೀಪಾ ಶ್ಲೋಕ Swamiji has lighted the lamp, dispelled the darkness. Deep Jyoti, Param Jyoti, Deep Jyoti Janardana, Deepo Hartume Pa, Deep Jyoti Namostute. Shubham Karodi Kalyanam, Arogyam Sugha Sampadam, Atma Buddhi Prakashaya, ದೀಪ್ ಜ್ಯೋತಿ ನಮೋಸ್ತುತೆ. ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್, ಐ ಆಮ್ ಎ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆರ್ಕಿಯಾಲಜಿ. ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆರ್ಕಿಯಾಲಜಿ, ಹೀ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಓನ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್ಸ್. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಎ ಆಡಿಬಲ್ ಟು ಯು? ಹೀ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎ ಹಿಸ್ಟೋರಿಯನ್, ಹೀ ಈಸ್ ಎನ್ ಆರ್ಕಿಯಾಲಜಿಸ್ಟ್. ಸೊ ಹೀ ವಿಲ್ ಆಕ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ he will accepting the proofs in support of certain arguments, otherwise he is not going to accept it. So after my post graduation, I had joined for the post graduate diploma in archaeology. That was in archaeological survey of India under Professor B.B. Lal. So he was going to for the excavation at Ayodhya. At that time, the Prime Minister of the country was Mrs. Indira Gandhi. Mrs. Indira Gandhi, Nehruji, they had a liking for art, archaeology. Very unusual liking they had for art and archaeology. And the minister in charge for culture at that time was Professor Noorul Hasan. Professor Noorul Hasan was the minister for education also, culture also at that time. And Professor B.B. Lal and Professor Noorul Hasan, they were very close friends, because Professor Noorul Hasan was earlier he was a professor in Aligarh Muslim University. So Professor B.B. Lal said that earlier he had excavated Hastinapura. We all know Hastinapura, and on the basis of the archaeological excavation, he proved, on the basis of the excavation, I am saying, not on the basis of the hearsay, and he proved that the Mahabharata battle had already fought with, and these were the regions associated with that one. Now, what are the regions associated with Mahabharata? We all know, one is Hastinapura, and then we have Kurukshetra, because it was in Kurukshetra the battle was fought. Then there were number of other associated, like Mathura, because where from Lord Krishna was there. Then Karna's Anga, Anga means that is in the present Bagalpur district, that is there. So all these were associated with Mahabharata. And then in order to avoid the battle, they said, you give us 5 villages. What are those 5 villages? Those 5 villages were, one was Indraprastha, Indrapath, Tilpath, Bagpath, Sonipath. So these were the 5 villages. Sir B.B. Lal went for the excavation at Hastinapura. It was a huge mound was there. He excavated it. Okay, anybody can excavate any place, and they will be getting certain things also. But how to associate it with Mahabharata? So for that, he used the literary evidences from Vayu Purana in order to support his archaeological excavation. What was that literary evidence? In Mahabharata, the battle was fought, and Pandavas won the game also. And then they were told, now you have to be the king. So Yudhishthira, he said, no, I don't want to be the king. Because for this one, for this throne, I had to kill a number of my own kith and kin, so I don't want. Then the next man was told, you be. He also refused. But you are a Kshatriya. Your Kshatriya Dharma is there. That you have to do. So who will be the next man? So they said, that should be the youngest of us. And who was the youngest? Parikshit. Parikshit was the son of Abhimanyu. So in Vayu Purana it says, when Parikshit was ruling, the eighth generation from Parikshit, not Parikshit, the eighth generation from Parikshit was ruling the country, there occurred a great flood. And after that, everything was washed out. There was nobody there. Everything was washed out. A great flood occurred and everything was washed out. And then people migrated from Hastinapura to Kaushambi. Where is Kaushambi? Kaushambi is in Allahabad. What is the difference between Hastinapura and Kaushambi? It is almost 420 kilometers. So Vayu Purana says, Gangeya Apahrade Nagaram Kaushambeyam. Gangeya Apahrade Nagaram. Gangeya Apahrade Nagaram. And the Ganga had stolen. Stolen means it was completely flooded and the whole thing was completely vanished. Kaushambeyam Sanivatsayate. Then the people migrated from here because of this thing. And then they went to this place, Kaushambi, and inhabited there. So during the excavation, he could get that flood line also. And then people had, after that flood, people had completely deserted the city, and then they went to Kaushambi and started staying there. So he saw that flood line here in the excavation. And then nothing was there, everything was washed out. And then he went to Kaushambi, excavated there, and there he got the continuation. So it was on the basis of this, he said, that Mahabharata had occurred, a fight was there, and in all these places he got a special pottery known as PGW, that is painted grayware. It was there in Hastinapura, it was there in all other places associated with Mahabharata, like Indraprastha. Indraprastha is the present Puranakila in Delhi. The present Puranakila in Delhi, that is Indraprastha. Tilpat, Bagpat, Sonipat, Kurukshetra, in all these places, at the lowest level, he got this pottery. And it was on the basis of this, and then it was dated. So it was going up to 1200 BC. So an archaeologist dating for Mahabharata would be 1200 BC. Sometimes the religious people, they may not agree with it. The astronomical calculations are also against it. But at the same time, an archaeologist would stick to his own principles. So it was on the basis of the, what is the next one? That is Ramayana. So for this Ramayana site, he told this very thing to Professor Noorlhasan and he agreed. And we were the members of the team. Now I will take you to my PPT and we will go through the PPT. Otherwise it will be taking a lot of time. Next please. You can, next. This is archaeology as a science started from 1780 onwards. There was a Italian city which was completely buried like this one in an earthquake. So that city, they started excavating it. So it is roughly around 1780 onwards. Next please. This is just to give you. And then when they excavated that city, they got a whole bazaar like this one. The entire township was completely buried. And when they excavated, they got a whole bazaar like this one. Like our Hampi Bazaar. If you go to Hampi Bazaar, it looks like this one. Next, please. So, as a science archaeology started from 1780 onwards, next, please. Next, please. The whole excavation was going on there. Next, please. And this is Professor B.B. Lal. So, it was he who had excavated Ramayana sites also, that is at Ayodhya also, and Hastinapura also, and we were under him. Next, please. So, if you go through the Vedas, the earlier epicenter of Vedic period, that was the present day Afghanistan and the upper part of India, that is Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati. In Rigveda, it is said there is a river Sukta, Imamme, Gange, Yamune, Saraswati, Shututri, Somam, Sajada, Parishnaya. So all those rivers are here. It goes up to Kabul. That was the first area, and then people gradually migrated to Ganga, Yamuna. Next, please. So here you can see near Ganga, Yamuna, all those important places. Atmane, Namitra, Amshajim, all these. So it was always known as a very holy land. It was known as Madhya Desha also. It was also known as Brahma Desha and Brahmarshi Desha. Tvam Deva Nirmidam Desham Brahma Vartam Pradakshade. This land, it has been created by Nirmidam Desham. It has been created by gods. Tvam Deva Nirmidam Desham Brahma Vartam Pradakshade. It was Brahma Desha. So because of that, all those activities, our present day Hastinapura, our present day Mathura, all the holy places are here only. Next, please. And there is the same area, Bagpat, Ahichatra, Tilpat, Hastinapura and everything. Next, please. And here we have the Kosala area, which was the place of Lord Ram. Next, please. This is Hastinapura Mount, before excavation by Professor B.B. Lal. He explored the entire area and all the surrounding area also. Next, please. And then he excavated at this place. At the lowest level, he got a pottery known as PGW. And he got certain iron tools also. Because for the first time, iron was introduced at that time. Before that, people were using mostly bronze. Next, please. So he got a pottery known as PGW, that is painted graveware. Wherever Mahabharata battle was fought, or whichever place is associated with Mahabharata, from all those places, we have at the lowest level this pottery. That is PGW. So in common parlance, we call it Mahabharata pottery. Mahabharata pottery, common parlance. Next, please. Again, you have the same kind of pottery from all the associated places with Mahabharata. I told you about that friend. Gange apahrade nagaram nagasahuye. Gange apahrade nagaram nagasahuye. Tyuktar nijakshur nagaram kaushambeyam sanivatsayate. So you can see that flood evidence here. About this in Vayu Purana also and in Matsya Purana also, there was reference about this great flood. It was on the basis of this one also, and also on the basis of the pottery, and also on the basis of the iron tools recovered from associated sites, he had come to the conclusion that this reference, particular reference is about this particular flood, and then everything was completely washed out. He had to go 420 km to Kaushambi and then excavate. Kaushambi is near Allahabad. Next, please. So all the iron tools. Why Mahabharata is such a ferocious battle?
Because it was the greatest battle after the introduction of iron. Till that time, iron, which is very strong metal, that was not there. That is why Krishna's, because it is an it is not a religious interpretation, it is the interpretation of an archaeologist. That is why our Krishna, he had a very powerful weapon. Why it became so powerful weapon? It was because it was he who extensively used it. His Sudarshan Chakra, he extensively used it. And it was a terror for his enemies. So it became like that one. Next, please. And their cities were also very well planned cities. And that had even sewer lines also. So these are the sewer lines. Next, please. And in this is in Ahichatra. Ahichatra, there were many temples, unusual temples like this one. This looks like a Buddhist stupa, but on the top of it, you have a Shivalinga. Next, please. Next, please. And in North India, if you go to a temple, before reaching Garbhagriha, on the right side, there will be a lady standing on a crocodile. On a crocodile, there will be a lady standing with a pot of water. What is its meaning? That means if a lady is standing in front of a temple on the right side on crocodile, that means that is a river Ganga. And then on the left side, in almost all the temples of North India, on the left side there will be another lady standing with a pot of water on tortoise. What does it mean? That means this is Yamuna. So before going to Lord, before going to the main deity, you are having your symbolic bath both in Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, the underground Saraswati that is not seen visibly, and then purifying yourself fully and then approaching Lord, whatever is it is, if it is Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, whatever it is. Next, please. So similarly, the excavation was carried out at Indrapath. That is the present Puranakila in Delhi. There also we got the same kind of pottery also, and a number of other things also associated. And recently, earlier we are all seeing there were rathas, that is chariots were there in all the battles. We also know about in Ramayana also there is a reference about a chariot. When the chariot wheel was broken, archaeologists will not believe it unless he get a proof of it. As a religious man, he may believe, but for everything he want needs a proof. And up to 2018, and this proof was not available. But then in 2018, at a place known as Sinoli, Archaeological Survey of India excavated the whole place, and it was Dr. Sanjay Manjul, the director of Archaeological Survey of India, who excavated it. A student of again Professor V. Bilal and also Professor S. R. Rao, he excavated, and for the first time he got the evidence of the chariot in 1800 BC, proving that whatever we had said in Mahabharata and also in Ramayana, you have got a tangible evidence for it from the view of an archaeologist. Otherwise, you may get a lot of references in literature. We are not concerned with the references in literature. We will take them as supportive evidence, but not as the main evidence. Now you may ask me, where is that chariot? Next, please. So, there we got a number of bodies. Normally, in Hinduism, we cremate the dead bodies. But along with the cremation, the burial system was also there in Vedic period. It was not known. Here you can see, a man has been buried. He has been buried along with a number of weapons. All these are bronze weapons. Because in 1800 BC, it was bronze weapons. But 1500 BC, this iron was discovered, and then the technology changes. Next, please. Now here, if you look at it, this is the man, Dr. Sanjay Manjul, a young man. He excavated and he got the chariot also, and he got a number of the wood portion. It was completely decayed. So you can see the wheels. This is one wheel, and then you have the second wheel over here. And here also you can see the wheel is there. And the front portion, that small, this one that was drawing it, the horses, that is here. That is also made of, inner portion was wood that decayed, but the copper portion that is remaining, that is here. Next, please. It was an imaginary reconstruction. It was like this one. So this is this pole which you have seen there, and then you have the wheels also like this, and there are wheels on the other side also. So only 2 years back this has been proved. No, Mahabharata was right as far as the chariots were concerned. Next, please. Next, please. Here again you can see the wheels and the pole also connecting it. Next, please. This is little bit more clearer. The same photograph. Here again this, next. Here again you can see. It was a very, very fine excavation. Sometimes in the excavation, we will have to use small paint brushes and surgical knife. Because you know, like a surgeon, you will have to work. Then only things will come out. This was one of the most minute excavations. Had it been an ordinary excavation, many of these evidences, and especially this portion, that would have been completely lost. So the credit should be given to Dr. Sanjay Manjul and Archaeological Survey of India also for this minute excavation. Next, please. So this is, of course, Mahabharata was painted at various many times, and one of the painting was during the period of Akbar's time. Next, please. And here the whole party goes for Vanavasa. Next, please. And here the play of chess in which Pandavas lost, that has been shown. And in the excavation at Hastinapura, the same kind of this one that was excavated from there, proving that whatever was described in that one, that was correct. Next, please. Now, of course, we are going to Professor S.R. Rao. S.R. Rao is associated with Bangalore, Mangalore and all these places. And he was my teacher also. And it was he who had maritime excavation, it was he who had proved that the whole thing which was described about Dwaraka, that was also correct. It was not a very big science at that time when he started it. It was not a very big science in India. But continuously he worked on the basis of, because of his dynamism, a very active man, very dynamic person. On the basis of his activism and dynamism, he was able to get a small grant, very small grant. Actually, the government of India, then also, even now also, they should have supported this kind of work. Next, please. So he trained a number of people, and I also had my underwater training under him. I am sitting here. Next, please. And because you know, in underwater archaeology, you cannot, I mean, in land archaeology, you can spend the whole day. But in underwater archaeology, you will have to go with your oxygen cylinder. So the timing is sometimes it's 1 hour, sometimes 2 hours. Even if it is online oxygen also, it has got its own timing. Then your body will be, I mean, the metabolic changes would be your body, in your body also. So it's a very tedious task. So it was that kind of task which Professor S.R. Rao had taken up. And then on the basis of scientific excavation, he could prove that our Dwaraka, it was in 10 feet deep water. Next, please. And he also got certain seals. This is actually a seal from Mesopotamia. Which means, if you are getting a seal from Mesopotamia, a Mesopotamian seal here in India, and an Indian seal in Mesopotamia, that means they were not only contemporaries, they even had trade relations with this country to that country and that country to this country. So that was the kind of science and art and architecture and archaeology which they had built up. Next, please. And he also got the bastions, because every township, you know, and there will be a fortification wall, and the fortification will be having bastions also, so that from the top of the bastion you can have a look over your enemies. So that bastion also you can just see part of it. You cannot get all those things as you get over the land, because in continuous, I mean, the wave activities would be there, so everything would be lost. But still he was able to locate this thing in 10 meter depth of water at Dwaraka. Next, please. And then the whole wall of the city, because I mean, what was it, this one S.R. Rao said, because you know the length of it is 4 kilometers and the width is 1 kilometer. That was his calculations at that time. It sometimes varies also. Next, please. And about Rama, because for the first time about Rama, we get evidence in 2nd century BC. That is almost 2200 years back onwards. We have this kind of terracotta Rama. This is Rama. This is, I mean, from Kaushambi. Next, please. And the name of Rama is also written there. Again, Rama is sitting here with his characteristic, this one, bow and arrow. Next, please. This is an abduction of the earliest picturized abduction of Sita. Here you can see, this is Ravan. This is in Los Angeles Country Museum. Here Ravana has been shown, but not in 10 heads, but his face has been shown. And at the same time, he is abducting Sita here. But Sita, she throws her bangles down below, so that would be a kind of guiding thing for Lord Rama and Lakshmana to trace her out. So I call Sita was the first archaeologist. Because you have to have some kind of evidence. It is on the basis of this kind of evidence we often develop our own science. Because you will be getting a very small leads. On the basis of the lead, you have to develop your own science. So she gave a lead to Lord Rama and Krishna. Lakshmana, that it is from here I have been abducted, because of this ring which she had thrown. Next, please. So again, when Hanuman was going to Lanka, of course, here again, Sri Rama, he gives his ring. Next, please. Again, we come to Professor this one, Lal, his excavations at Ayodhya. Next, please. And this is whole Ayodhya. Next, please. And I was a young member. Here is Professor B.B. Lal, Mrs. Lal, and then our entire team. And this is Dr. Soundarajan, Dr. B. Narasimhaiya. I think he is from Barkur area. He is related to Professor Soundara. He was second to Professor B.B. Lal at that time. And Professor Narasimhaiya, it was under him we had our training. I am sitting here, down below, along with my friends. And this is Jayashri. Jayashri is from Madras, but she is the wife of Jairam, Jairam Ramesh. She was also, Jairam Ramesh was the cabinet minister in Rajiv Gandhi's ministry and various other ministries also. She was also there along with him. Next, please. So this is the, during the Holi festival, we are all celebrating the Holi festival there. We were there for 2 months for the excavation team. Next, please. So before the excavation, what we do is, we go for an exploration. The entire area will be explored and then we will go to that excavation place and excavate there. So during this exploration, we went all over the area. So we were just staying just outside the controversial mosque at that time. And when we went inside the mosque, we were stopped. There was a police person. He said, no, you cannot go. This is as per the court order. So we said, no, we are, I mean, researchers. We don't have any connection with either with Hindu group or Muslim group. We are just researchers. So they went us, allowed us inside. So when I went inside, I saw the whole mosque, 12 pillars of the mosque. 12 pillars of the mosque, that was not the pillars of the mosque. That was temple pillars reuse for the mosque. It was not my discovery, it was discovered earlier also. But I was just going as a student. This temple
part, you would be having Purna Kalasha. It is said it is a full vase like this one. It would be Purna Kalasha. It could be Purna Kumbha also, you can call it. Mangala Kalasha, you call it. Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnartha, Purnamudachyade. It is in almost all the temples you will be having, in North Indian temple you will be having this Purna Kalasha. This is a symbol of prosperity in Hinduism. Even now, if you are receiving any of the great Swamijis, like, we cannot receive them with a shawl. We cannot receive them with a garland. We have to receive them with Purna Kumbha or with Purna Kalasha. That is what Agama says. So that kind of, I mean, 12 pillars were made of this one, temple pillars. And then there were the drawings, I mean this one, etchings of this one, various gods and goddesses also. But that was erased from there. Very laboriously erased from there. So it was very obvious. And if you have any doubt, even now, you can go to Qutub Minar. Just by the side of Qutub Minar, there is a mosque known as Quwwatul Islam Masjid. This mosque has been built by using the remaining parts of 27 temples, Hindu and Jain temples. There is an inscription also, an Arabic inscription is also there. And in a book known as Tajul Masir, it is very clearly written that 27 temples have been destroyed. Certain wrong things have happened in Indian history. When the Muslims came as invaders, they have destroyed a number of temples. You cannot justify it. You cannot justify all those things. And at the same time, I say that the present day Muslims are not responsible for those things which was done by their earlier people. But Muslims become responsible the moment they try to justify it. They should not justify it. Yes, whatever had happened, that had happened long back, that was wrong, they should condemn it also. And they should not go for the justification also. That is what is happening. Now what is happening, the Muslims will immediately start justifying it. So that is where they have gone wrong. So if you go there, you can see a number of reused temple parts even now in Quwwatul Islam Masjid. Not 10, 15, 20, 25. More than that. I'll just show you. Next, please. And so this is just before this. So this is, the whole case was going on. So what I did is, it was not a big problem at that time while we were excavating it. In 76, 77, it was not a big problem. But in 1990, it became a very big problem because the Marxist historian like Irfan Habib, Romila Thapar, R. S. Sharma, all of them went to the press. They said that Ayodhya was excavated by Professor B.B. Lal. After the excavation, he could not get anything associated with the temples, and there is no need for the Muslims to hand over the entire structure to Hindus. Professor B.B. Lal said, no, we have excavated, we have got the temple parts also from there, a number of things, not only these 12 pillars, but again a number of things we have got from that area, but we have not gone to the press, because if you go to the press, that will be a very big issue. So we wanted to solve the problem, that is why we have not gone to the press. But this Marxist historian, in order to outsmart archaeologists, they went to the press, they created a problem, and they started saying that Professor B.B. Lal had excavated and he did not get anything associated with temples there, and for that, because of that, the Muslims, they should not hand it over. So they wanted to support the Muslim community. I was in Madras at that time. I was a deputy superintending archaeologist in Madras Circle, Archaeological Survey of India. My probation period was not over. If your probation period is not over, the problem is you cannot give any bold statement, because you know, the government, if you give any statement, the government can dismiss you straight away from your service without issuing a show cause notice. So I was in a very, very precarious condition. So Professor B.B. Lal said, no, we have got the evidences. But he was not very vocal, because those people, they had a lot of press connection. And the whole party, Communist Party, was there. So at that time, I just discussed about all of these things. And Professor Dr. Mr. I. Mahadevan was there. He was a great archaeologist also. And he was a great IAS officer also. And at that time, there was a, I mean, even now there is a paper, Din Malar or Dinatandi, I think, in Tamil. So he was the editor of that one. I wrote him a letter saying, sir, that I had excavated, I was a member of the excavation team there, and we have got many things associated with Hinduism and with temples also there. Then I was in Madras, so he came to my room. He said, Muhammad, this is a very important evidence. It should be published. Then I discussed with Dr. B. Narasimhaiah also, because it was he who was the in charge at that time. So he said, let us do it, and we'll have to face the problem, because you know, there will be a lot of problem. And at that time, we never thought that BJP would be coming into power at any period of time. And it was a Chandrasekhar's government at that time. And I gave a statement in Indian Express. It was widely published by Indian Express. And I said that I was the only Muslim who had participated in that excavation under Professor B.B. Lal. And we have got many things associated with temples. And there was a temple before the mosque. So that was my statement, first statement. And the second statement I said, this is as important for Hindus as Mecca and Medina are for Muslims. Hence Muslims should willingly hand it over. Willingly hand it over. That was my statement. Immediately, this was a great shock for the Marxist historians, because you know, they had wide connection with the entire press. They had wide connection. It was a great shock. They wanted to retort, but they could not. They could not, because you know, I said that I was the only Muslim who had participated in that excavation. And then I gave all the evidences also in Indian Express. Immediately, the Secretary Government of India, he came, he said, I am going to dismiss you from the service. I am going to dismiss you from the service. How did you make a statement like this? So I said, sir, Loga Samgrahame Vapi Sambashyan Kartum Arhasi. Whatever I had done, this is for a general cause, for a good cause. I have no any personal ambition in it. I don't want any personal interest also. So then he said, I am a Brahmin from Allahabad. His name was Tripathiji, R.C. Tripathi. I am a Brahmin from Allahabad. You are teaching me Sanskrit. Are you teaching me Sanskrit? I am a Brahmin from Allahabad. So, I am going to suspend you right now. Again, he repeated. Then, again I quoted another Sanskrit shloka. Swadharme nidanam shreya. Sir, even death is also welcome for this act of mine. He was completely blown over his feet. He said, Mr. Muhammad, what you have said is right. It should have been spoken by an archaeologist. And you are an archaeologist. It should have been spoken by a Muslim archaeologist. And very fortunately, you are a Muslim archaeologist. And I have got great respect for you. You have spoken it out very well. But there is an order for me to take action against you. I said, sir, you can take any action, sir. I don't have much responsibilities also, but I stand by what I said. Then I Mahadevan, he was a senior IAS officer. R.C. Tripathi is a junior IAS officer. I Mahadevan went to him and she said, he has spoken out whatever should have been spoken by others. So, of course, you are under instruction to take action against him. So you transfer him from one place to another place. So they transferred me from Chennai to Goa with independent charge. Now with independent charge, with full charge, I was transferred. So I knew the game of all these people. That is the Marxist historians. And especially I was in Aligarh Muslim University also. I fought with Irfan Abi for 10 years continuously. For 10 years. So, and now the case was, the case came to Supreme Court. Every day hearing was going on. So I knew, because I knew the mentality of this Marxist historian, I knew that when the final judgment is approaching, they will be coming out with their press statements, either in Times of India or in Hindustan Times or in Indian Express. These are the mostly three newspapers which most of the judges, they read it. So they just wanted to make up the mind of all these people. And I knew their. So what I did is, before they went to the press, in the month of November, that is in 2018, in the month of November, I mean things were going on, 19. So I went to the press, I gave a very big statement, before this one. Yeah, this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, a 6 column statement by me saying that there was, the temple was there in the first excavation also and in the second excavation also, because you know at that time we had got only 12 pillars. But when the second excavation was carried out under Dr. B.R. Mani, more than 50 pillars in 17 rows were excavated. More than 50 pillars in 7 rows were excavated. So I went to the press. I said that I was only Muslim at that time. But in the second excavation under Dr. B.R. Mani, there were other 4 Muslim officers in the excavation. So what this Irfan Habib and other people said, they said no, excavation was carried out, but they did not get anything in support of the temples. And the report which was submitted by Dr. B.R. Mani, that could not be relied upon because he is not only the report of Dr. B.R. Mani, it was a combined report of all the people who were associated with the excavation and who are those people associated with the report. And I started counting the name of the Muslim officers. There were 4 Muslim officers. And one was Ghulam Hussein Khaja. Ghulam Hussein Khaja, G.S. Khaja, he retired from Nagpur. I gave the evidence. He retired from Nagpur as director of epigraphy, Persian and Arabic epigraphy. And the second man, he was Atiqur Rahman Siddiqui. I gave again, he retired from Agra circle. Agra and Delhi, these are 2 very important circles of Archaeological Survey of India. Only senior officers would be appointed there. So that was Atiqur Rahman Siddiqui. Then Zulfikar Ali, he was the third man. He is even now, he is working as the superintending archaeologist of Chandigarh Circle. And then A.A. Hashmi. He was a very good archaeologist, and he retired from the Bhopal circle. I gave the names of all these people. And saying that, you know, all these people, it is the report not only submitted by Dr. P.R. Mani, but also by these people, they are also the co-authors of the report which was submitted by the Supreme Court. And then the Supreme Court has to accept this report, whatever has been submitted by them. So that was a devastating, this one statement against the Marxist historians. Immediately, I knew they would react. They came. They gave a false report. They said K.K. Muhammad was not there in the excavation along with Professor Bibi Lal. This because, you know, they have got connection, wide connection with Times of India and other thing. So normally, if a report comes like that one, they should have consulted me. They should have sought my comments. But because of their connection, they did not seek my comment. They published it in Times of India itself. Next, please. Here, K.K. Muhammad was never part of Bibi Lal's Ayodhya excavation team. So this is from Aligarh Muslim University. A person is there, Dr. Nadeem. He is a very close person of Irfan Habib. They gave this statement. And at that time, Professor Bibi Lal was not in India. He was in America. I immediately contacted him by email. And then he issued a correction. And he issued, said, no, K.K. Muhammad was along with me, and gave the all the, not only the press statement, he also gave the photographs of the photographic evidence. At that time, photographic evidence in 1976 and 70 was not very much there, but we had few photographs, and that was also given. And that way, we could prove that all these communist historians, they have made it a profession to speak lies. Professionally, because, you know, it is a very well-knit organization. You just cannot easily fight along against all those people. They will be completely, they will not allow you. If you go for any kind of selections in any interviews, you know, they will not select you. You might be very well qualified as a professor, but they would not select you. It is such a very good network is there. So immediately that was there. K.K. Muhammad was never part of Bibi Lal's Ayodhya. Next, please. And in the same length, K.K. Muhammad was with me during the excavation at Ayodhya by Professor Bibi Lal. So this way you will have to go, you will have to give it tit for tat. And if you become a very good Sanatani, you would not be able to do many things. Sometimes, you know, you will have to hit back like Krishna. Like Krishna, you will have to hit back. Otherwise, you know, they will gulp you down. Next, please. So this is, and now, of course, it was in 1992, it was demolished. Next, please. And when I went there, I could see these pillars. All these are Kasoti pillars. And there was an image of a god here. And this is that Purna Kalasha that was also rubbed off. And here you have the Hara. Next, please. Here you can see that Purna Kalasha, Purna Madam, Purna Mida, Purna Artha, Purna Mudachyade. Next, please. And this is in Qutub Minar area, Quwwatul Islam Masjid. Here you can see the Purna Kalasha, and foliages would be coming out. Not only that, here you will be having the Kirti Muga of Lord Shiva also. Here you can see, if it is a mosque, you will never have a Kirti Muga. You will not have any representation of human being. You will not be having any representation of animals also. It is against the tenets of Islam. Next, please. Next, please. Here you can see the temple bells also, reused. Next, please. Next, please. Just look at it. It is again from Quwwatul Islam Masjid. Can you see this sculpture? This sculpture? This sculpture, this sculpture, all these are Hindu sculptures, Bharavahaga. In temple architecture, we call it Bharavahaga. Next, please. And all these are gods and goddesses. Just look at this room. Next, please. You can see Mahavir Jains. Next, please. Here you can see a dancer. Do you think if it is a mosque, a dancer would be there? Next, please. And this is Nabichanda. It is a stylistic, this one, a kind of dome, this one, ceiling of Hindu temples of 12th century in North India. Next, please. And again, you can see, this is all from Quwwatul Islam Masjid. Next, please. Next. And the flying figures. Next, please. Next, please. Viali. Next, please. Egadanda, Ganeshji, Egadandam Chaturvahu, Gajavaktram Mahodaram Siddhi Buddhi Samayuktam Mushigaruta Mevaja. If there is any God who has got both Siddhi and Buddhi, that is Lord Ganesh. Next. Lady figure again. Next, please. Next, please. A number of sculptures. This has happened. Let us accept it. Things have happened. That was wrong. Let us call it. And if we can make remedial measures now, let us make remedial measures. Let both Hindus and Muslims come together into one single harmonious whole. Let us make a new, bold India. That is what is needed. Next, please. All these things. Next, please. And then, while I was there in Delhi, I had a lot of fight because, you know, in Qutb Minar and Quwwatul Islam, Muslim wanted to offer prayer. So our rule is, Archaeological Survey of India rule is, that at the time of taking over a monument, if there was puja, that puja would be only allowed. For example, you go to Aihole, Pattadakal, Badami, all these places, there is no puja there. Because at the time of taking over, puja was going on only in one temple and only that would be permitted. But these people, they want everything should be open. I said, no, it's not possible. But sometimes you, with extremists, you cannot argue. Next, please. And then I had to deploy police. Next, please. Yeah. Arguments. Next, please. Then, that is what I said, that I deployed police. And Chidambaram was the home minister at that time. He supported us fully well. And everything was stopped. If you take a strong action, you know, things would be rough. Otherwise, you know, if you just give them laxity, they would have their own way. Next, please. And this is Dr. B.R. Mani, the man, the great man who conducted the second excavation after Professor B.B. Lal. Next, please. And so when we went there, along with Professor B.B. Lal, on the western side, when we excavated, we got a number of pillar bases. And these bases were for the pillar to stand, because you had to strengthen the whole area. So there were, we got only 12, but in the second excavation conducted by V.R. Mani, more than 50 pillars were there, and 263 idols were excavated from there, of various gods and goddesses, ladies, various other things. So had it been a mosque, do you think any of these idols would have been there? No, not only that, no. And not only that, and there was an inscription of 20 lines, which very clearly says that this temple is dedicated to that Vishnu who has killed 10-headed person. Who is that 10-headed person? Ravan. And who has killed Bali. And who is that? So we got, you can just see this one. These are the pillar bases over which the pillar that would be standing. Next, please. So, Nandi, this one, trenches were excavated. In all of them there, there are pillar bases were there. And then, at the same time, many other things also associated with Hinduism. Next, please. Here also you can see the same kind of pillar bases. Walls. Next, please. And this is a diagram of that one. In each trench you can see this pillar. 1, 2, 3, 4, all the pillar. Next. And there was a circular temple also, a circular temple also. Next, please. And just see this lady figure. You can have it in a temple, but you cannot have it in a mosque. And not only 1, 2, 3 like this one, 263 pieces. Next, please. Just look at it. Next, please. This is the lower part of a human body, that is the leg portion. Next, please. The upper portion of another, because you know, human representation is completely prohibited in Islam. Then how do you expect to have all these things in a temple area? Next, please. This is a lady drummer. Can you ever think of a lady drummer in a mosque? Next, please. This is a horse. Next, please. This is a dog. Dog for Bhairava is all right, but not for a mosque. Next, please. Again, many dogs like this one. This is a serpent. Again, in a Hindu temple you can have, but not in a mosque. Along with Shiva you can have Vasuki. Vahanam Vrishabho Yasya Vasuki Kandabhushanam Vame Shakti Dharam Deva Vakaraya Namo. Or you can have it, I mean Vishnu also. And then Amalga on the top of the temple, that portion also we got it. Because in North India, on the top of the temples, Amalkas would be there, Nellika. So that would be there on top of it. And over that, the Kalasha also would be there. Next, please. And this is that Amalka. Next, please. Next, please. And many pillars like this one, with Purna Kalashas. Next, please. Next, please. Many drawings of the temple drawings like this. Next, please. And this is another very interesting evidence. This is pranala. In a mosque, you will never have a pranala. What is a pranala? Because every day we have to do the abhisheka. And that abhisheka jala, that would be going towards north only. That is why wherever a river like Ganga, Yamuna takes a northern course, Uttaravahini we call it. Gangotri, Yamunotri, Haridwar, Lakshman, Jula, in all this place. And Prayag also. That river takes a turn towards north side and that becomes a holy place for us, Uttaravahini. And Pranala, that is, it is known as Makara Pranala. What is a Makara? Makara means crocodile. And it always, you know, that is a symbol of river Ganga also. So that Magara Pranala, which is an essential part of a temple, that also we got it from here, from the excavation. So the water will be coming out through this hole and it would be coming out. Next, please. Go to any of the temples, even here also. You have, this is Bhojpur temple. Bhojpur temple is one of the biggest South India. I mean, this is lady, I mean, as I told you, this is Magara tortoise, but the front portion is just fallen, this one damaged. That is why it is not very clear. The lady, next please. The wall, there was a huge wall also there. Next please. And as I said, a huge Shila Falaka. It is known as Vishnu Hari Shila Falaka. This Falak very clearly says that this temple has been constructed by Govinda Chandra. Govinda Chandra was a king of the 12th century, 1150. It was constructed by him. And then it says, it is dedicated to that Vishnu who had killed Bali and who had killed 10-headed person also. Next, please. So this was also, this is that one. Hall Shila Falak. And immediately this one, Marxist historian said, no, this is not an original one. This is a plant. This has been brought some other place and it has been planted here. Then they said, after one person would say, no, this is now a modern one. Another person would say, no, this is an old one brought from some other places. And all this kind of, they just wanted to create confusion because, you know, in the battle they have been very badly beaten. But now, because, you know, once, I mean, they rose up, when the archaeologists rose up, then they were very badly beaten, but now they wanted to create confusion. They tried, but they could not. Next, please. And this was another inscription. A number of inscriptions saying that it was a temple of the 12th century, which was excavated from there. Next, please. And a lot of historical evidences. Historical evidence in Ain-e-Akbari. In Ain-e-Akbari, it was written by Abul Fazl. He says that in the month of Chaitra, a large number of people congregate here in order to worship Lord Rama. Next, please. And these are all the historical evidences. After him, William Finch. William Finch was this man, Englishman. He had come to India during Jahangir's time in 1608. So he again says that there was a large gathering of people in order to celebrate Ram Navami there. Next, please. Then, series of evidences like this one. So we have got both archaeological evidences now, that is on the basis of the excavation, and also series of evidences given, literary evidences. So on the basis of this one, it was conclusively proved in front of the Supreme Court of India that there was a temple before the construction of the mosque, and that temple belongs to Vishnu, and Vishnu Hari Shilafalaga is also excavated from there. And on the basis of this, the case should be decided by the Honorable Supreme Court. Honorable Supreme Court, of course, took time, but they gave a very perfect judgment. I was not expecting this kind of beautiful judgment would be there. It was a wonderful judgment, and that has settled the entire problem for the country. Now time being. And now what we have to do is, we have to bring together both the communities. We should not isolate Muslims. Of course, we can have differences, but at the same time, both Muslims, Hindus, Christians, and all the communities, they should come together. We have to create a uniform and unified and a very stronger India, and that is what is required now for the country. And thank you all, and especially for the Swamiji, for giving a very patient hearing. Thank you all. Thank you very much. Sir, thank you. Yeah, thank you. Sir. Yes.
ಪೂಜ್ಯ ಪುತ್ತಿಗೆ ಮಠಾಧೀಶರು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಿಂದ ತೆರಳುತ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮೊಹಮ್ಮದ್ ಅವರ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹೊತ್ತಿದೆ, ಆನಂತರ 12:15 ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾವು ಪ್ರಶಸ್ತಿ ಪ್ರದಾನ ಸಮಾರಂಭವನ್ನು ನಡೆಸುವರಿದ್ದೇವೆ ಅಲ್ವಾ. Thank you.